A very good evening to one and all. My name is Dr. Suti Sahani and I'm from Faculty of Management Studies. And on behalf of Faculty of Management Studies, I would like to extend a warm welcome to all of you to the fifth webinar, which is being hosted by the department. Well, we all have heard that there's something called as change, which is constant. And I'll say that in the last couple of months, we have seen that how that transition happens. So from seminars, we have already shifted to webinars. That's a change. So with this transition, we are today going to talk about the transition in the field of marketing. And for the same, I would like to welcome on behalf of the department in university our two speakers. First, I'd like to introduce Mr. Vivek Jain. Mr. Vivek Jain has a tremendous experience of 19 and a half years. He has worked in corporates of Nestle and Tata. Welcome, sir. Sir has done his PG in the field of HR and finance and is also an enthusiastic sports person. Well, for today's session, before I introduce Saksham, I'll say that there are a lot of similarities between both the speakers. They both love traveling. They both are young marketeers and they are here with us today. Well, to begin with, we have the second speaker for the day is Mr. Saksham. Mr. Saksham Sharma has a experience of 6 years and has worked in various walks of marketing like healthcare marketing, consumer marketing, sports marketing, and is currently working in the field of digital marketing for Philips. He's a 2014 pass out from IMT Ghaziabad. And as I was saying, again, Saksham's passion is all about fitness, writing songs, which is a unique quality. Someday we love to hear that, Saksham. Also, he loves traveling.
End of the year. End of the year.
Yes. So I would like to welcome, extend a great welcome to all of you. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your time. To begin with today's webinar, the topic of the webinar is past, present, and future of marketing. And of course, when we talk about the various facets that we have seen the transition. So the focus would be what has changed, what was and what is. So we'll set the ball rolling. And if we talk about the flow of the webinar, the flow of webinar is in front of you. We'll start with a bit of introduction. We'll talk about the key market trends, current crisis, and everything that COVID has changed post-COVID, and then the questions of our audience. So Vivek sir, over to you. Welcome and thank you for sparing time. And on behalf of Faculty of Management Studies, I'm really honored to have you with us. Thank you.
Thank you. I hope I'm audible. Yeah. Shruti, tell me, Shruti, if I'm audible.
Yes, sir, you are. You're very much
okay. Hi, everyone. So, I mean, who all have 29 is what I see the score here. Welcome, a good welcome on a Saturday evening. So I have tried to keep the PPT as interactive and as useful to you as possible, because what I want you to take at the end of both of us is something that can be of some use to you in basically understanding what the current market is and then what is it that the companies are looking at and how are they doing it. Yeah. So one of the things before I start, I would want everyone to understand that this is a mix of sales and marketing. While we are in MBA colleges, we normally don't look at sales. We always talk about marketing. As soon as you come to the corporate world, you get to know what is sales and what is marketing. Yeah. So let me tell you some, I mean, there were some 16, 17 trends that you could clearly outline what most of the FMCG companies, or in fact, most of the companies in this sector were up to. And these were common across, they cut across all the industries. So when I say that migration from a linear supply chain to a connected supply chain, I will give you an example of Bosch and Lomb, which is the world's largest eyewear company. So normally what happens is in a distribution channel, the company pushes the stock to the distributor pushes the stock then to the stores. Okay. So what happens if the distributor is out of stock? So the retailer, of course, has to wait. I think so. There's some.
The presentation is not visible.
The
presentation is not visible?
No.
No.
Just one second. Just 1 second, sir. Yeah, is it visible now?
Yes.
Yes, and I think sir's network has.
Let's also check with the participants if it's visible to them.
Yeah. So I hope the PPT is visible to all of you and the screen is visible. Sorry for the inconvenience, just give us a minute. I'll see that going to be an excellent screen. Yeah, I think he has joined back. Yes, Vivek, sir. Sir, you have to unmute yourself, please. No, sir. So you have to unmute yourself. See on the right side, there would be a
pen. Yeah. Is it audible now?
Yeah.
So everyone can hear, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So we move from, just the point that I was making. So what happens if we can make 2-3 distributors service a particular retailer? So that is all that can help. I mean, technology can help do that. And that is something that Bausch & Lomb tried, and it helped the out of stock. So whenever a stock is not there at any of the retailers, they could directly log into the app that was given, and they could then, there are app operators in India also which do that. Just to understand, the point being removal of any of out of stock or the time that the product was not there, that was the time that it helped. Yeah. Of course, there's no denying the fact that as soon as technology is coming in, it is boosting. And most of the FMCG companies are looking at rural growth, because that always was ahead of the urban growth. So, coming on the FMCG startups, you would have seen, heard about ID Batter. Okay. So that is one of the good FMCG startup examples that you see. There are a lot of FMCG startups that have come in. There is obviously a lot about digital that Saksham will also speak about. Yeah, digitization is also something that we have seen with the kind of people. Everyone that you see is now on mobile. Yeah, companies also focusing directly on health and taste. So Nestle, there was a launch of Maggi Veg Atta some years back, and that is clearly around 8 to 10% of the total noodles that we sell. That is only for guys who like to have some bit of health connotation. So something like a brown bread. You know that it is the same, but with a lesser guilt. So, so one example is also Tetley introducing a green tea mango. So there's nothing that a full mango is there. It is more of looking at the taste, because the barrier to a green tea is basically the taste. I would not want to have green tea because it's bitter. Yeah. The aggregator driven model in food, you are aware of the Zomatos and Swiggy's, so I don't need to say anything on that. Yeah, and then probably I would want to show you some of the links where brands have connected regionally with a typical. So what has happened? What has technology led to do in starting of 2020 and last year that we saw was we are kind of geotagging specific area, specific state. We would have specific ads and specific things targeted at that particular state. So what does it give you? It gives you that sense of belonging. So I would not want to play all the ads because we would be short of time. I would want to play Stuti's, if you can just play the first one, the UP ad. I am not very sure that people would have seen this. Just enjoy it. Just put it on full screen. any of the links you can play. Yeah, no problem. Probably it is already, yeah, it's already. I can't hear it, but Saksham, can you hear it?
No. Now I can.
I'll again play. Just for a second.
दिल्ली का फुल शोशा है, फुल हाईफाई. वेडिंग में पीकॉक ही होनी चाहिए और स्टेज और ब्राइड की सिस्टर का लहंगा सेलिब्रिटी वाला ब्लैक बैग सोफा शैंडलियर सब रिच लगना चाहिए एंड नॉट टू फॉरगेट फाउंटेन डिजाइनर और गेस्ट लिस्ट ओह
लगता है ये अभी ही जा रहा है
चलिए चलिए सबको चाय पिलाइए और आप सब डिनर करके जाइएगा लेकिन दिल्ली की सबसे रिच चीज ना दिल्ली का दिल है बहुत रिच ऐसे रिच दिल वाली दिल्ली के लिए हमने प्यासा की प्रीमियम दिन रिच टेस्ट वाली बनाई है एक प्याली रिच टेस्ट वाली एक प्याली दिल्ली वाली
Yeah.
You want me to play the other one as well, sir? The Haryana or Punjab one?
Anyone that should do. Yeah, yeah. Shruti, you can move. You can move to the next.
Yeah.
Next slide. Yeah. So yeah, you can move to the next, and then you can move to the next. That's also done. So let me now, take you all to what's trending. What's trending basically letting you guys know what actually is happening right now. Of course, work from home, just like you guys, everybody's working from home, like you are studying and doing your online classes. That has become a reality. Also, most of the labor that has gone back from states like Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, most of them have gone back. So labor is a very important aspect of all the manufacturing and all the supply chain, right? So this migration has happened, and this is an ongoing challenge which companies will have to look at. So there will be supply disruptions, and then there will be manufacturing costs which will increase. So that is something that the companies will have to look at. Now, this was all happening at company front. What is happening in retail? What is happening in the store? or where me and you go and buy. So of course, the local kirana store, which was right next to us, there are society groups who are, their WhatsApp groups are formed. There are people who are delivering in society. So as marketeers, as brands, you have to think about what is the right move to do right now. Because there was once that it was just the modern trade where you would go and shop, but now it is back to the kirana who's there, and he would push whatever brand that he has there, right? Because availability is still the king. If one brand is not there, it is easily replaceable by another brand, right?
Very true.
Yes, you can move.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yeah. So there was some understanding of shopper behavior. What happened? So that I explained. Now, just a point to ponder: what has changed with COVID? Has it changed everything? So I mean, the outcome of this slide and what I want you guys to understand is, it is not that COVID has changed everything. The most important point being, it has just accelerated some of the things, some of the trends that was supposed to happen 2 years down the line. Now take, for example, e-commerce. Across FMCG companies in 2016-17, it was just 1% of the business contribution. Now, the current trend that we see, because of people staying at home, people ordering online, this is just the percentage has just zoomed up to 3%, which, I mean, the companies thought that it would be by next year or probably after 2 years. So that's the difference that has happened. So basically, everything was going to happen. It is just that it has got accelerated. Now this is being a busy slide, I will just take a minute to explain. There are, I mean, with the start of the year, already saw that there were a lot of things. You saw a Make in India that was going on. There was a lot of other countries also apart from India that were just turning inwards. I mean, they were doing a lot of things that they wanted to, everything to stay in their own country. So, I mean, we see France and we see other countries where they say that now the food supply chain was actually held by Chinese. And I say it was held by Chinese, basically a lot of things in that supply chain was provided. The raw materials and the finished products both were provided by Chinese companies, which they have now said that we have to own it and we have to work on it. So the anti-China rhetoric is actually going much more louder. So it was anything to happen. Supply chain, reinvention in supply chain. How do we supply? How do we cater to the end consumer faster? How can we do the turn faster? That was all always there. This is all. So just my point being, and what I want you guys to understand is, it's not that the whole world has changed, everything has changed. It is just that there were trends that were already there. They were happening in the market. I mean, digitalization. We all knew that this is the world where the world is moving. But it is just fast forward. I mean, most of the companies have a pretty serious and sincere digital department now, thinking on what to do. Apart from what we do offline, that's very important on what we are doing digital. Yeah. So, yeah, can we move to the next slide?
Yes.
Yeah. So then we got to all the experts. So experts, they predicted that 6 things will happen. And then this was a very nice article in Times of India. 6 things that are going to happen that are going to hit us. And of course, so first recession, something like 2008, what happened, and we are already into recession at that point in time. But me, students who are listening, I mean, all the 31 of you don't have to worry about anything. These are all economic measures which keep on happening. I mean, you were never affected when a recession was there or when the world was doing really good. These are more for economics, just to understand, just for you to assimilate what is happening around the world. So one of the trends that we saw was work from home could lead to a lot of open spaces being left in offices. And if those offices, those open spaces could be then given into people who don't have homes, we could find homes for a lot of people. So that was again one of the interesting trends. Movies, Shakuntala Devi released yesterday. So you know all the movies. Lakshmi Bomb is coming. So I'm saying a lot of things are happening online now, because I mean, cinema halls will take a little bit of time. In terms of airlines, you have seen most of the airlines across the world have gone bust. I mean, IndiGo just reported it's the worst quarter that it ever had. Yeah. Yeah. So the we can move. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
So again, this is just an extension of what I explained. Suti, we just move ahead. No problem. Yeah. So of course, healthcare is supposed to become a poll issue. Of course, because it is not that. Understood that what are the doctors and what is the ratio of our doctors and hospitals once COVID came. Before that, it was never there. We always thought that no, we had enough, or why do I need to go to a hospital, or why do I need doctors? The healthcare industry suddenly just zoomed up. So it will automatically become a poll issue across the world. It's not happening only in India. It will also become a typical issue across the world. Yeah. I already told about airlines. I mean, you might do lesser number of flying hours, but you might have to pay a bit more. Yeah. Of course, the office canteens, and typically for us, where we went for our breaks and for our Sutta breaks, we went to most of these places and outside, they will typically look different for some time. Zoom and the go-to webinar that we are doing. This hybrid model is a way of life. Yeah. Yes, we can move. Yeah, of course. So just a bit on this. Don't try to read or understand. I'm just telling you the gist of it. I mean, earlier what happened? You see all these startups coming in, and there was just one name that was flashing in. The owner or the co-founder, he was receiving a lot of funding, and he was the only guy who was who was there in limelight. This suddenly has now changed. Now there are people, there is a labor force, there are people who are also important to make that startup or to make that incubation. This capitalist narrative, which was there till now, has suddenly got a paradigm shift. Everyone in that particular organization is important, even if it's small. It's not, I mean, the owner just cannot do everything on its own. Yeah. So that was important. Yeah. Yeah.
No, but with the point that you have made, and if you don't mind, can I ask you something? And you'll be able to give me insight on it.
Yeah,
so
sure.
When we talk about the shift from the modern trade, and people are not going to these luxurious stores in the malls and buying stuff, but are preferring online. So do you think that there's going to be an impact on the job of sales as well? Because, you know, when you talk about targets and when we talk about marketing being more of on the field job, and right now with the change of circumstance, it has become more of off the field job. People are pitching 18 hours, 19 hours straight. They are working at home. In fact, Saksham was telling me the same in the morning as well. And with your marketing experience, so with that kind of a perspective, do you think that the transition would be smooth for all of us? Because, you know, change is something that's never that easy.
So I'm only saying that there would be some job losses. That is for sure. But yes, this is more of a temporary phenomenon. So I mean, wherever e-commerce for that matter, or you might want to have a digital world, but you just cannot live with it. The only reason being, we as consumers always want to touch and feel, right? So it might rise, as I mentioned in the earlier slide, it might rise because it has just got accelerated. That need has just got accelerated because all of us staying at home. But it would never go. So I am saying it is more of a temporary phenomena till the time we find a vaccine, or till the time, I mean, things are over. But yes, there would be, I mean, everything will be questioned in terms of what is the job they're doing, what is it that you're giving to the company. That is getting questioned right now. Like a no man's business. I mean, it was never there, but it is now getting questioned, only because there are issues in terms of sales, and there are issues in terms of profits. That's why.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Should I move to the next one?
Yeah. Please. Yeah. So now this slide clearly tells you what is it that brands could do after. After COVID is foregone story. Yeah. So typically, just look at the four points that are there. So you will have to, I mean, the companies will have to have a search, I mean, something like a search partnership with most of the e-com players or most of the players who do online marketing. You will have to win that. So you will have to bid for that. You will have to win that. You will have to, because there's a certain algorithm to the product search that is there. I mean, if I type T on Google, just TEA, it would directly guide me to an Amazon website where it will directly tell me that you buy a Red Label or a Tata Tea. So there's a specific algorithm to it. The companies will have to invest and will have to win over it. Okay, there are separate agencies that we'll have to do. Companies will have to master that.
Right. So there's another question for you, if you don't mind.
Somebody asked to ask you
that when malls are changing, what impact will JioMart will have on Indian consumers moving from mom and pop, Kirana shops?
I'll tell you, JioMart is an interesting bit. I mean, moved at least the retail space. But frankly speaking, as of now, none of the FMCG companies, as of now, and I can tell you after 3 months also, none of the FMCG companies are thinking much about it, because the current state of JioMart is such that it is basically a platform that has come, that is basically in competition to the fully grown e-commerce players. So there are two things that JioMart is going to do in future. One, it is going to serve the Kiranas. Okay. The second, it is also going to sell things on the website. They are the only two things that JioMart is going to do. So on the bit of Kirana piece, on the bit of Kirana or the smaller stores which it's going to service, companies will have to think, well thought about strategies as to whether their distribution channel of the current distributors is good enough, or they actually want to partner with JioMart. The second bit, it will go all along just like any other player, like a Amazon, Flipkart, Grofers, or a Big Basket. So that will continue. So as far as we are concerned, we know it is just a very, very minuscule percentage that is there right now. But yes, we have to be prepared, because this is an Indian company, does not require any licensing, just like a Amazon Amazon requires. So it will spread much faster. But we have to know, as a FMCG company or as any company, what is it, the route that we want to, the route to market or the route to consumer, what is it that we have to choose?
Thank you.
We can move. So this was just an example, and just I wanted to tell you, a direct to consumer has become such a norm these days in the new normal. You look at Domino's app, just go to your phone and just to get Domino's app, and Domino's has started selling essentials. And I am telling you, it's because the Domino's stores were closed. So they had a lot of people who were sitting. A lot of delivery boys who were sitting. So they contacted all the FMCG companies. They said to FMCG companies that we are making a combo. Deliver us all the stocks at our DCs. DCs are basically distribution centers, from where our team will take over, and then they will. So you see here, there's a 755 rupee combo of oil, rice, dal, tea, typically of all the essentials. So I'm saying this was an opportunity with which most of the companies did. There were players like Zomato who also started Zomato Market. Sorry. Apart from restaurant delivery, they started this. There were also players like Domino's who started this. Okay. So this is again something of a post-COVID world. So just look at the highlighted portion. So this basically is there are some experts of marketing who normally dwell upon most of these things. Most of the companies do, but it is quite clearly outlined in these 3-4 thoughts that I've written. It's more to do that it is a journey that had started happening. We have to live in this new normal, and for that we have to be close to the consumer. The brands have to live to their purpose. You cannot just preach something and do something else. So that time is just gone. Consumers today are much more connected, and they have this dual behavior. When I say a dual behavior, they will behave differently when they shop online, while they behave absolutely differently when they go to the Kirana and do their shopping. So that is something that company has to understand. They have to listen and they have to imbibe in their culture and go ahead. Yeah, typically, if you look at the part on education and access, is also because you have to look at behavior. You have to look at behavioral pattern, which was never there earlier. You could do a mass thing, one size fits all, but it has just gone. Just gone away. It is very important to look at customized geotag. Something that is required only for a particular region or a particular set of people. So that is, your priorities. All the companies are working on their brand priorities to be much more sharper. What is it that needs to do? So if you could just play this start, that is a video that you already have.
Yes, just one second.
So what we are wanting to show you is a tea ad, which of course the company that I work for, that we only made, but this was in line with times. Yeah, just play. Yeah, so just a point on being socially relevant at these times. You know that our elderly, our mothers and fathers and your grandfathers and grandmothers, they all are in such a state that they need to be taken care of. The elderly need to be taken care of the most. So that was just to give you an example of how brands can be socially relevant at the current times, right? Yeah. We can move to the, I've already taken 3 minutes of your section. So I think so.
No worries. Very informative for me as well.
Yeah. So some of the, I mean, brilliant ads that are there around. So this is the ad which was there, in UAE from Lexus. Just an ad, just holding there, see, just clearly saying heroes driven by Lexus, and ode to actually all the health workers. Stuti, if you can, right? I think so. That slide is getting missed. All the links. Yeah. So I am not very sure that we would be able to play. I always wanted to play. You can note it down and you can go on the YouTube and look at it. We'll just play two of them. One, let's play the Nike one if it's possible, Stuti.
Just the first one.
If it's possible, yeah. Yes. This is amongst Nike's ad, which released just 3 days back, and it has been making waves. Last 3 days, I saw it yesterday, and it is some 23 million views. I think so. It would have, got much more right now. We will just play just the two ads, and then probably we can move. No issues, not playing.
So it might just take a couple of minutes. In the meantime, you can just discuss and give me a couple of seconds. I will ensure that.
Okay, no issues. So just the point being that, all the ads, everything is just pointing. So the point is, it is not like a stop that has happened because of COVID. Everyone is thinking ahead of COVID. So the ads also are very much pointed towards what is happening next in the world. So everyone knows that this year is almost a year that has already gone by. All the big players are only thinking how good we start 2021. That's the spirit that all these ads are there, and they are all very, very relevant. Also to cover, you would have heard of the George Floyd killing and Black Lives Matter, that whole movement that's there. So most of these, you would have seen our biggest FMCG company in India changing the name of Fair and Lovely to from Fair. It has removed Fair from Fair and Lovely. Yeah. So all these all changes, as I said, these all changes have just got accelerated. And today, for anything to become, take a sort of frenzy and be available across the globe, it takes much, much lesser time. Yeah. Is it playing? So that's just one, and then we'll move. Yeah. Yeah. You can unmute it. The sound is not there. The sound is. You can make it full screen. it's not. I think so. The audio is not there. No problem. No problem. We can we'll move.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I think so. We should move because Saksham has his session. Otherwise, we'll keep on continuing. He will not get time.
Oh.
Sorry. So sorry.
So the same film is also there in one of my slides as well because
no.
We can keep it at the back and then we can revisit it.
Yeah. Stuti, you can stop it. There's no problem. These guys will see. Nike, I've already said to see on the net. Yeah. Let's just go on the last two slides and we'll wrap it up there. Is it hung? Yeah. Just move. We can go to the next slide. Yeah. So just look at this. This is one of the most brilliant ads from Japan. Now, we all know that the Tokyo Olympics has been extended. Just look at this. They just don't want to go with the spirit of next year. This is extended to next year. And see what they have done. 2021. I mean, absolutely brilliant. Yeah. Just to retain the legacy. Yeah. Just come to the next slide. Just come to the next slide. Yeah. Stuti, I think so. Yeah. Just come to.
Is that on net?
I think so. Yeah. Some lag. Yeah. So this I have explained overall. I mean, I don't want you guys to read most of this. I mean, just a point on accelerated digital offerings, which Saksham will ably cover. Just a point on that. Yeah. So basically, you have to have your brands. They are associated with a purpose. Yeah. So Shruti, you can move. You can move to the next. Yeah. Yeah. So also very important for all the brands to revamp their marketing strategies and why it's important, because I mean, there's nothing like I was. So if you guys are reading newspaper, and I would encourage you guys to do, 3 days back, something that hit Reckitt Benckiser really, I mean, something that happened with Reckitt Benckiser, which never happened. Dettol became market leader, beating Lux. I mean, this has never happened, and this could have never happened except for all of us who are taking Dettol so much and then using our hands. So I mean, the brand manager or the marketing manager would have got thrilled, but that has not happened because of him. That's because of the natural factor that is happening. So I'm saying there is no normal now, right? Everything has got a change. And I'm saying you have to think on your feet. You can't take your old accolades and think that, okay, this is what I have been doing in the past and this will continue. This is certainly not there. So you will have to continue reinventing yourself, continue looking at how can you closely be with the customer, with the shopper. So I think so. Just the last slide. I can see Saksham already there. Stuti, if you can put in the last slide.
For me, the screen is hung and
absolutely. I just see. Yeah. Just the last slide, Stuti. Just go to the second last slide. That will be the last. The application is not responding. Yeah. So this is just a slide on what our government should do. So there are a lot of things we can Stuti move. Yeah. Of course. So I'm just highlighting on I'm just look at the highlighted words and then you will get to know the gist. I mean, of course, there's a digital innovation which Saksham will take you through. Of course, one of the biggest winners of all this is going to be India, because I mean, people are most of the countries are wanting to move things out from China, and probably India will be in a stage where if it can capitalize, if it can, I mean, the manufacturing setups can be future ready. India will be one of the best. Winners. One of the key things that India would have gained, that India would have taken a lot of time, is that one. Yeah. So thanks everyone. Sorry, Saksham, again. I've taken.
No worries at all. In fact, let me start with a thank you to Dr. Deepti, Dr. Stuti, and to Vivek as well, and to all of you for taking out time on a Saturday. So Vivek, I think thank you so much for your presentation. I deeply enjoyed it. I loved every aspect of it. In fact, what it really helps me do is, I'm glad you went first, because now there's enough and more context for the kind of topics I want to cover. But before we start, Stuti, if you can move into the next slide, please. Hi, Stuti, are you there?
Hello, Stuti, you can put in Saksham's PPT.
Stuti, you can actually make me a presenter. I can also present, but in case there's any network issue. But I'm not sure if Stuti can hear us, so we can wait.
Technological glitch.
Yeah. Happens literally every day.
And she was also saying, no, there's the rains that are happening there.
Yeah. In fact, yesterday also, from what I heard, there was a big warning. There's going to be a lot of rain in Delhi. And I was actually coming back from Delhi. And I was really worried that if it rains too much, you know how Delhi, you know, there's a lot of water problems in Gurgaon specifically. So nothing happened yesterday, and so far nothing has happened today.
Okay.
Predictions were way off. I don't know how to share my screen. I think only Stuti can provide that access.
I mean, otherwise we don't use GoToWebinars, right? We use Microsoft Teams.
And
Google. Yeah, Teams. We only use Teams, or might be some external vendors. Then we use Zoom.
Yeah, it's not allowed in my organization.
Yeah, so we also, I mean, we don't use, but if some external vendor calls up,
one of you have to.
Easier. I think so. Teams is much more easier than any of these. I mean, much more user friendly.
Absolutely. Like, we had Skype earlier, so I was very okay with Skype also.
Right.
And now we shifted to Teams, so Teams also is pretty good. It's much better because I don't have office emails on my phone because it keeps ringing all the time. So I have Teams on my phone. If somebody needs to reach out to
Absolutely.
Me.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. Yes, Sudhi.
Can't hear you.
We can't hear you.
Still can't hear you, Sudhi. Sudhi, can you hear us? Can you make it full screen, Sudhi? I can see the slide. So Sudhi has texted she is facing audio issues. She can't hear us.
The phone and the picture looks really, really sleek.
So just to give you a background, Vivek, I actually, in 2018, I was there at Manav Rashna to give a small session on digital. And this is the same thing. Yeah, so I really like this picture too, so I did not change anything.
Yeah, that's nice. So probably she'll make us join again.
I think I have access now, so let's see. Can you all see my screen?
Yeah, just make it full screen. We will.
Cool.
Yeah.
So my screen is completely visible now, right? And my audio is okay?
Yeah, audio is
perfect.
Fine.
Perfect. So again, thank you, Vivek. That was a great session. And from the point of view of my session, the general ecosystem information that you have provided in terms of updates will really help.
Wow.
Quick question. It could have been more interactive. Had it not been a webinar, but just a question for everybody. Why do you think TV shows are called as soap operas? Any answers you can ping on the chat window if you want. I can take a look there, or I can just directly come to the answer. This is just something that has always intrigued me, so I was just researching about it. And any clue from anybody? Vivek, any guesses?
Oh, sorry, I was on mute. Probably we slip.
Pardon?
We slip. That's why we slip. We have and they go on for a very long time.
Close, definitely close. So I'll just go to the answer. Essentially, TV series were called as soaps or soap operas because the original ones, which began in 1930s, were produced and sponsored by P&G and Unilever, and that's how the name came.
Yeah.
So it was with stories and ads of hopes. So just a little info because this is something that intrigued me always. So I was researching about it from time. So with your context, TNG still has a production house, and if you Google it, you'll find at least 10-12 different shows that they've produced over the years. And recently, they're also getting into a partnership with National Geographic to create more content. Cool. So a great. a topic that was touched upon by Vivek was on brand purpose. And another key point to notice right now that the changes that we see in our ecosystem, primarily digital or any other ecosystem, have only been accelerated by COVID. They were always there. So if you look at researches, and there's always a discussion around brand purpose, like what's the brand purpose, this brand name, but what's the purpose? So the brand purpose essentially, you know, brand needs to have an identity apart from just the product that it's selling, and it needs to have a voice of its own. So as per research, 57% young people believe that brands should use their advertising to raise awareness of social or ethical issues. And if you look at COVID, what has happened in the recent trends is consumers don't want brands to do a hard sell during the crisis. Their expectation from the brand is for the brand to be empathic. Empathy is a very big factor that all brands are using in today's tonality. Vivek has also confirmed that if you go across with Google, YouTube, Adidas, Nike, all the brands today are focusing on this very big thing on how they can help you get through this time. And a big reason for India also, if you look at India's demographic, then 65% of our population is under 35 years of age. It becomes really crucial. Just a couple of examples I wanted to table here when I talk about brand purpose. One is Nike. So Nike defines its purpose to unite the world through sports and create an equal playing field for all. One of the points that Vivek also pointed out was around George Floyd and the whole Black Lives Matter movement. So this is not a new movement. This has been going on for a while. If you read more about the US history, you realize that slavery has taken a very big percentage of US history, and the kind of circumstances the Black community has gone through has always been underappreciated. In 2018, Nike did a campaign where they got Colin Kaepernick. He plays, he used to play in the NFL. And when he took, he bowed down on his knee to protest, and he did not stand up for the national anthem. And that was a protest. And Nike made him the lead of that campaign. It's a beautiful campaign called Dream Crazy. You can read more about it separately. And the whole Black Lives Matter movement is also something that Nike has always stood by. And that has helped them. And there's a reason that, you know, the Nike's core audience is millennials and Gen Z who are actually buying more and more of Nikes. It's not 40-year-old plus men or women, because for them, they are not replacing their shoes as frequently as possible. So Nike has to tap into this particular audience for their future growth. And this is something they've done superbly well. But it's something I really want all of us to, take cognizance of, that brands cannot fake it. You have to be sincere in your efforts, and you have to ensure that, every action that you're doing speaking that same tone. Brand purpose is not something that you can just, say something and get by with it. You have to ensure that it holds up everywhere. The new film that you see here, and I'm sure Suti will share the slides, is the same one that Vivek wanted us to show. We can go through it later. So this is what Nike did really well in this campaign, and their sales also went up. Their stock prices went up, and they had it over $2 billion in valuation 1 week after the main film went live. And if I talk about a brand that didn't necessarily do it that well, was Pepsi. I'm not sure if you guys had heard this or not. This is back in 2017. Again, surrounds the whole Black Lives Matter movement. Kendall Jenner comes up on the screen, gives a Pepsi to the cops over there, and everything goes back. And Pepsi faced a lot of backlash behind it, primarily because Kendall Jenner shouldn't have been face of the campaign. So just goes on to highlight the point that, brands have to be authentic, and brands have to be, consistent in their efforts. You can't fake it today. Consumers will find out, and you will face backlash. We've been discussing marketing trends of the future, and just wanted to highlight some of the ones that I personally think will dictate our lives in the near future. From a marketing standpoint, from a media standpoint, we'll see brands and organizations spending more behind these facets. Something that Vivek already touched upon was how they've been, creating separate creatives for different regions in India, and that always does really well. This is something we've tried in Philips as well, by running regional edits across different markets, and that has something that has given us much better returns on our spends. If you look at from the graph on the left-hand side, you would notice that India is one of the fastest countries to acquire more and more consumers on the internet. Jio really sped that up in the past 3 years. The kind of transformation and the kind of growth e-commerce has seen, that was not something that was there earlier. More and more consumers are entering, are coming online in India. That is definitely helping their lives. Demonetization was a big play on Paytm, and if you look at COVID, then there's a big jump that Vivek has also pointed out for e-commerce online. If you live in a society, you would have noticed MyGate has suddenly peaked up big time. because of the whole amount of information that you can get online. The future, however, for India, particularly from a media standpoint, is vernacular. India is not, homogeneous. There's multiple languages, and we all know about it. So you need to ensure that the content which is going out from your end, your brand website, everything, is speaking to everybody. You have to be inclusive. You have to ensure that English is not the only medium you speak with, or Hindi. You have to go regional, and you have to ensure that same consistency at every touch point, because your consumers are spread across. AI and machine learning.
Am I audible? Saksham, there's a question for you. Sorry, I'm back. I'm sorry for the technical glitch, but So
is it a question I can see on the
I'll just ask you. So the question is, how brand relevance and social orientation genuineness was there before also?
It was there, but I can't say that it was there for every and each and every brand out there. Think about it like this. 10 years back, what was the awareness about climate change? It was there. It was there in pockets. But if you look at what's happening today, Greta Thunberg is someone who is known across the world today, and she's not that old. So the climate change awareness is something that is coming through today. Brands are now becoming more socially conscious. If you look at supply chains for clothing industries, where there's the maximum amount of clothes being turned out, they are taking more and more conscious. H&M has a whole chain called as Conscious. Zara also has something similar. And these are two of the biggest, retail giants which are there in this context. From a tonality standpoint, you can easily bucket brands into two. Ones that are loyal to the kind of communication that they are making. So if you look at Nike, for example, because that is something I was tabling earlier, Nike came out with its first campaign in 1988, which was the Just Do It campaign, right? The first time that campaign ever came about. So the one that I was talking about was the 30th anniversary of the same campaign. Nike has consistently and always communicated that same thing, that they're going to help you improve. They're going to help you improve your performance. And that is something that they consistently communicate by their technology that they bring in the footwear, the dry fit technology that they have for clothes, or be it in their form of communication. Versus which other brand should I talk about? If you look at Apple, then they're always focused on technology as a big aspect of their. So I think brands have always tried to, remain authentic. But the way brands used to tackle social issues or societal issues and bring them in their campaign has changed. Ariel came up with the Share the Load campaign, and that was amazing for that time. And if you look at the kind of work that's happening today, brands are becoming more inclusive. And I think that has to do with society overall. Everybody today is more conscious of how they speak. Everybody is more politically, and I hope they are going forward, because that's the kind of world you want your children to grow up in. That's the kind of world I want our children to grow up in. Does that kind of answer your question? Because it's a very subjective one.
I hope so. Thank you. Please continue.
So another trend which is already there is the AI and machine learning. Sorry. Please were you saying ahead. Something? I could not get.
No. Okay. Please go ahead.
So AI and machine learning are words which are consistently being thrown about, and this is something I'm sure everybody is already hearing, but this is only going to grow up. And this is only going to go up. Now, if you take a step back and remember the words that Vivek already talked about, which was algorithm. Algorithms are dictating our lives today. If you go to Netflix, Netflix knows the kind of content you're watching. It comes back to you and tells you there's a 99% match for the show. You're going to watch that. If you go to YouTube, then you start noticing that the kind of music you're listening to, YouTube is going to keep showing you. Similar artists, similar kind of, for example, if you're watching movie trailers, then you'll start seeing more of those reaction videos, more of those. So this is only going to grow. If you go on Amazon, the recommendation engine is something, one of the most powerful recommendation engines out there is Amazon. And they're really banking on it. And they're really, doing great work with it. And machine learning is something that's, continue to stay there. And it's only going to help. Mass customization, mass personalization, all of these things are very possible by machine learning. So I won't spend much time here. I'll move to the next one. This is a good one. So basically, right now, if you notice last year, I think a couple of years back, the overall searches on mobile actually crossed desktop, which had to do with the fact that you know, more and more consumers are now accessing internet via mobile. In India, maximum consumers, access internet via mobile, not desktops. India crossed that entire journey. There was no broadband penetration in India, and there still isn't as high as, you know, the mobile penetration is. But going forward, you notice that there's, you know, smart assistants on your phone. There's Siri, there's a Google Assistant. You have Alexa in the backyard, and Alexa is going to be connected to more and more things. Honda has already built in Alexa in their cars. Hector, MG Motors also built in that. So the whole interconnectivity of devices is something which voice marketing is really going to control. And going forward, you will see a huge, huge jump here. And if I talk about from pure numbers standpoint, the global speaker market is actually growing much, much faster than the tablet market. So this is something that I personally really enjoy. This is virtual reality, and virtual reality is continuing to grow big time. On the right hand side, if you could notice the GIF, this is a Game of Thrones activation which was done with Snapchat. There's a Flatiron building in the US, and you can see the dragon land on it. For modern trade, there have been some amazing concepts done by Snapchat. So Foot Locker is a very big global chain that houses a lot of sneakers and clothing apparel, specifically dominating the sports. And they partnered with Nike to create a very interactive VR communication, where if you scan the code, you would see LeBron James jumping through the posters and doing a hoop. Now imagine this is something that you can just have everywhere you go. All your outdoor campaigns tomorrow, the kind of hoardings that you see can be made more interactive. So just think about the possibilities from a VR standpoint. Again, if you look from a COVID time and the new normal piece, consumers want to see the brand, consumers want to see the product in their houses, consumers want to see that particular dress on them, which is why go to a mall. So this is something that can really, really, really become big. Sky is the limit for this personally. AR and VR is something here to stay and dominate. Data to drive key marketing decisions. This is something that, you know, all marketing organizations have been consistently focusing on, but this is also something that Vivek also pointed out. You know, geotagging and reaching out at the right point in the right time. We were discussing the whole debate around, you know, if online commerce is something that's going to take over modern trade. I personally think absolutely not, or traditional trade, absolutely not. Consumers want the product whenever they want it, and they want it in the best possible price and best possible quality. The future of, you know, touch points is always going to be omnichannel. Brands are going to focus definitely on online, but they also want to ensure that consumers can find the right same product, you know, in the nearby shop. So for example, if you're looking for XYZ product, you go and you search on Google, Google will come back to you and tell you, you know, this is available in X store, Y store, or you can go on online. So omnichannel is something that's definitely here to stay, and, you know, data will really help you ensure that you reach your consumers with the right message at the right time. So from a new normal standpoint, COVID has really changed a lot of things, right? Vivek has captured the entire ecosystem. What I'll try and answer are, from a media standpoint, what has changed, right? Because ultimately, you will have to, as a marketer, have to make choices where you spend. People are spending more time online streaming. Entertainment has gone up consistently. People are at home. So, you know, the demand for music consumption, movie consumption, everything has gone up. Spending more time on smartphones and video conferencing, something we're already doing, that's happening in parallel. I won't spend too much time on the numbers, so they will share the deck with you, and you know, we can go through it. But the time spent on online has consistently gone up. During the day, there used to be limited TV consumption and limited mobile consumption. Both of these things have gone up considerably. Just a small stat, on weekends, 35% more time being spent online. News has definitely become very strong because consumers really want to know more and more information. They initially, there was a lot of panic about the virus. I think things have settled in much better now. Also has to do with, you know, the amount we have time we have spent at home and grown used to this new normal. News has become stronger. Online is growing. This is something that has really happened very recently. The gaming space has exploded big time. More and more games have been downloaded. India has been able to produce some of the best games. So Ludo King, for example, I'm sure all of you guys have played as well. That has gone up big time. If you look at it from a split standpoint, then everybody is playing more and more games. So from a marketing standpoint, a lot of brands are actually focusing and spending their advertising money on games. Just a very small point, and this basically I think covers both Vivek's point and my point together. The brands of the future will be built on essentially two fundamentals. They either have to be top of mind or they have to be top of algorithm. So, top of mind, we all understand marketing, essentially right communication, going out at right touch points, positioning, distribution. All of these things are something brands have to be socially conscious. Your brand needs to stand out. And why I'm saying it, so I'll just spend 2 more minutes on this slide. Earlier, some years back, before online wasn't as dominant, and the internet wasn't there, it was very difficult for brands to really get somebody to launch a brand. There were many entry barriers. Online has really and fundamentally disrupted that. You can start a very small store and you can start small and you can go direct to consumers and continue with that and still build a brand. So brands like Beardo, brands like, you know, Bombay Shaving Company, Man Company, all of these brands would have found it really difficult to come out in the past. Today, because they went direct to consumers, it is relatively cheaper to advertise on. You can directly compete with the big players. They have been able to, you know, between the recent acquisitions for both, it has gone up. From an algorithm standpoint, I'll take a step back and I'll come back. So if I talk about digital per se, and if I talk about the two biggest ecosystems, so there's an entire ecosystem for Facebook, which is Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, which takes up a very, very, very big chunk of, you know, consumers. The second biggest chunk is the Google ecosystem, which is your search. Search is huge. You know how many the billions of searches happening every day. YouTube is the second biggest, and then they have the entire app list and everything else. So between these two were the choices for any digital marketer to go out and ensure that we are covering these two touch points, reaching out to the consumer with the right message on social, ensuring our search strategies are in place, etc. But recently what has happened in the last 5-6 years is Amazon is gaining big ground. So if I give you a small example, earlier I was spending as a marketer out of 100 rupees on digital, I would spend roughly 60-70% of my budget on the Facebook as well as Google ecosystem, because they're the strongest and they allow me so much information on the kind of audiences I want to target, which communication should follow, which communication, sequential messaging, all of these things could be captured. But slowly and steadily, Amazon is the one who's eating into all of these pies. So Vivek pointed a very specific thing on the search piece, right, and algorithms. So for a brand today, roughly, and this is the data which came about a couple of years back, I'm not sure if this has gone up further, was the number of searches on earlier consumers used to go to Google to search. Right now, the product searches, 55% of product searches have moved to Amazon in the US. You know what that means? That means that the brands need to invest heavily on Amazon search, invest heavily on their products being visible in the first frame. So if you look at Google search, I'm not sure, but I never move past the first page. It's very rarely do I ever go to the second page, because Google is so good and it gives me the right information on page one. Honestly speaking, I just check the first 3-4 links. I don't even go beyond that. Now, all of those searches are moving to Amazon. So brands have to now pull out that money from Google and start investing behind Amazon. Second, algorithm means that, you know, it is dictated by the kind of page views that your product is receiving, the rating and reviews, the frequency of purchase, pricing, and a couple of other factors that Amazon will not disclose, which is why algorithms are going to dictate our life, not just from an Amazon ecosystem standpoint, but everywhere else as well. So for a brand to really stand out, if it, and here I will, you know, remove the traditional definition of a brand that has to be a product. I'm even talking about musicians. I'm even talking about movie makers. Everybody has to ensure that they fit into the algorithm as well. Otherwise, your content will not be discoverable, or your brand will not be discoverable. So this is just a couple of points. If there's any questions, then we can move ahead. Otherwise, I'll just take it to the last slide, which essentially covers both of these things.
So we have got quite some questions, and I'll request you to complete so that both you and Vivek sir can answer the questions.
Absolutely, absolutely. So Vivek already pointed out, you know, D2C as something that will really go up going further. And I completely agree with that. India is adding more and more consumers online because of this is number of online shoppers that you see here would have drastically gone up as well, primarily because COVID has accelerated that further. So for a brand today, the need for direct to consumer will give you a better understanding of the consumer. You're faster to market. You can test something, launch it quickly. You don't have to go through distribution centers, etc. There's an increased control over the merit, because otherwise you're struggling with the kind of media touch points that you're using. If you're an Amazon focused brand, that you're dictated by Amazon processes, Amazon policies on how content can be presented, and Amazon algorithms, or Flipkart, or XYZ. So as a brand, if you're direct to consumer, you can do things much faster, you can do things much quicker, and that is something why this is the right time to build a D2C brand. Again, there are multiple options if it's going to be a hybrid, pure play, D2C, etc., that you can look at. But long-term wise, D2C is here to stay, and it will only continue. And here I would like to add another point from Nike. So Nike has already decided that they will not partner with Amazon going forward, and they'll focus their energies and efforts on the D2C store. I am a big sneakerhead, so I rarely follow the kind of drops that Nike keeps doing on their website. Nike has a whole ecosystem created specifically for D2C. And this year, so far, Nike has had huge losses. All retailers have had. But Nike has seen over 30-35% growth in their direct-to-consumer business models. Which is why I personally think this is a great time to build a D2C brand, break free from the clutter, have your own narrative out there, and consumers will come to you if you have a great product. After which, I would just like to focus, this is the last slide, I believe, yes. So just to give you a small background on what you can do in digital, and how do you go about it, is Google basically classifies these as four moments that you should always think of, which are I want to know moments, where consumers are looking for information, I want to go moments, I want to do moments, and I want to buy moments, and which basically cover every touch point and every possible place where you as a brand should be present. That's it.
Thank you so much, both of you, Saksham sir and Vivek sir. It was a great session. So now we have a couple of questions for both of you, and it would be great to hear it from you. So my first question is that how much sales e-commerce for Tata consumers and Philips actually happens? Do you have any idea on that?
Vivek, you can't hear Suti? No?
Just one second. I think there is a... he's being muted. Sorry.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Suti has had unmuted me. So, yeah. I always encourage college students and the MBA students to actually look at the newspaper. So, if you would have read the newspaper, Nestle results came in 3 days back. And I mean, not even it has never come, but Nestle, the CEO of Nestle, Mr. Suresh Narayan, he made a statement that e-commerce for the first time has become 3% of their quarter sales. I mean, 3% of the company sales, and grew at 122% with Philips and with not even knowing Saksham's numbers, but I'm saying with Philips and with Tata, both across e-commerce currently before COVID was around 1.5-2%. Currently, it is in the range of in the same range. I mean, it has gone a bit of 2-2.5%, nothing more than that.
For Philips, actually, so we have multiple categories, right? So, for example, yeah, male grooming, and if I talk about them, they have been growing year on year online. And I can't give you the specific numbers, but they're much higher than that. They're 20x of that. So, 30-40% is online contribution already. That has to do with the TG as well. But if I talk about categories like domestic appliances, which has always been focused on a 30 to 40 year old, 30 plus audiences, right? That has also steadily grown right now because of COVID, because consumers are staying more and more at home. So kitchen appliances have gone up drastically. If I talk about male grooming, and this is something I missed capturing in my, was the consumer trends which are evolving. So this is a huge at home. Consumers don't want to go out. Haircuts at home have to jump. The searches for hair at home have gone up. So male grooming, a trimmer franchisee, hair clip, all of this has seen exponential jump during COVID. 30% month on primarily right now.
Yeah. So next question, that is, there is that, is network marketing place its position during COVID-19?
Stuti, can you come back to the question? I could not hear it.
Is network marketing place its position during COVID-19?
Network marketplace. So does that mean connect place?
I think so. I'll request the participant to please ask the question. I think the words are missing in it. I'll move to the next one.
Yeah.
Just one second. How much, Ajay, this is being done and e-retail is not more than 10% of retail even in developed markets. So your comments on it.
So yeah, so e-retailers are not even 10%. No, it's not true. China, it's almost close to 11.5%. And that's true for South Korea. These are two markets where it's pretty developed. For UK, US also, they are in the range of 10 to 11%. Now, again, the same point. They have grown exponentially in terms of typically non-foods. Foods, they have grown, I mean, something like tissue papers. So there was a shortage of tissue papers across and typically outside in UK. But they cannot compete with the brick and mortar stores. The growth is exponential, but again, it would settle at some point in time. I mean, it would gain 200, 300 bips, which it was supposed to gain after 2 years. It has actually accelerated and fast forwarded right now.
Great. Okay. And we have time for one last question. And that is Philips website or campaign in top 100 ranked by views?
Sorry?
So there's a statement that has come from one of the participants and they say that is Philips website or campaign in top 100 ranked by views? So viewer ranking basically.
Okay.
The advertisements on the website.
I don't have a way to get that. I literally have to go through tons of YouTube videos to just come to that. But I personally, I'll answer that question a different way. The way digital was approached earlier, before you know everything became paper. Earlier Facebook, before you know everything that you see on Facebook wasn't really pushed to you by a brand. Organically, content used to be discoverable, right? Today there's no such thing. So it really depends on the amount of investment you're making behind anything, and you can rack up the video views. Which is why I never go after video views from a ad. But recently we partnered with Med6 to create a video. We did spend some money behind it. It was a Father's Day video that came out, and we had over 18 million views on it on 2 days. Trust me, only 10% of it were actually paid. Rest of it, because of content, it went out. We had over 60,000 shares on that, which is the highest that Men 6 has ever seen. But because the content really resonated, it was a depiction of how fathers were there earlier and now, and what has changed. And fathers have always gone out and, you know, instilled confidence in their kids to go out and conquer the world, and that still remains. And I think that touched a chord with the viewers. But I don't have a direct answer to come back and say that, you know, if my ads rank in top 100 or not. No, I don't have an answer.
There is another very interesting question for both of you, sir. That is that what percentage of Tata consumer and Philips products have social purpose?
So good question. So it's not measured as a term of percentage. So I mean, most of the Indian companies, they normally have some portion of their profit going into the social cause. So the only line that is being made during the new normal or the COVID is your brand should be socially relevant. To that purpose, it should touch upon some of the social aspects. So the ad that I showed you of Tata Tea, that was touching on social, though still it was more to do from caring for elderly. So if that counts, I mean, as a company, you will always want to make profits because we are there for profits, but you also would want to nurture this social. So there cannot be a percentage attached, but yeah, most of the brands I say it goes for each and every food brand and non-foods also. They would want to reduce their carbon footprint. They would want to reduce the usage of plastic. They would also want to do some or the other social cause. So, I mean, most of the companies would have done something for PM CARES Fund. They would have done for some or the other NGO. They would have done. So, I mean, it is not a mathematical number of a percentage. But yes, overall, yeah. Most of the companies would would have one or the other lining of doing something for the social cause.
But before Saksham also answers this question. Saksham, I'll just like to add something to it. So when whenever we talk about this social cause marketing, you know, overall, if we see various companies, and it's been since long, if I remember correctly, during my school days, I remember Nokia coming up with an advertisement that we recycle mobile phones. So that, right. You know, the environment is... So do you think that with the help of social cause, the marketing is more... So marketing is more of a science than creativity. So it has to be actually, you know, put up in an apt manner that it touches people's heart and consumer's heart, or they feel.
Absolutely. So you are one. I mean, marketing is a science. It has to be actually put forward in that way. I mean, the basics of it remain the same. So I never wanted to take the example. Now I'm taking it. So I would encourage the students to go to this website known as Jago Ray. So if you look at the campaigns right from the time Amjad Khan was the brand ambassador till today, so every time Tata Tea would have taken one social cause. So it might be that during elections. So I mean, we all have grown up and we have seen that one or the other.
Correct.
But the whole point being, it has to be relevant to the current times. That's very important. I mean, you can always say, you can always tell that we are socially relevant, but most important is relevant, and relevant to the millennials, relevant that it seems to guys that are out there today. I mean, we know that more than 50% of our population is less than 30 years old in this country, and they are the guys who are going to shape up the future after say, for example, 10-15 years. So we have to be socially relevant to them. They have to see the purpose in this, and I mean as I said, there's no specific percentage. Yeah, Saksham.
Over to you, Saksham.
So from a Philips standpoint, so Philips as a brand promise, it's that we are here to make your life better. Earlier we were an innovation and new brand. Now we move to, we're here to make your life better. So every messaging that goes out from Philips is a never negative. So even during COVID, we've always tried to come up with a solution that this is how we can help you. Now, if I divide Philips into two organizations, earlier Philips was three organizations. One was the consumer lifestyle business, which was trim, shavers, beauty products, domestic appliances. It was lighting, which was there earlier, and healthcare. So lighting has been divested. So the consumer business as well as healthcare. On healthcare front, Philips has always gone out and, you know, produced kind of products which are required for India, be it Make in India ultrasound machines, which have recently came about. Talking about sleep apnea as a disease, for the past 3 years, Philips has been the only brand which has been consistently talking about sleep apnea. It's a very, difficult disease, and your primary caregiver, like a physician, don't really know how to detect it. Approximately 8% of a certain population demographic in India is infected by it. They don't really know about it. It's only because I was working with Philips. It's why I got my father-in-law tested, because I learned about it and I went and I got him checked up. He has sleep apnea, but with the right amount of treatment, he's doing much better. If I talk about the CSR angle, then Philips Foundation is something which is run globally, education, healthcare across the world in poorly developed economies in Africa and the Middle East. In India, we have focused our energies from a CSR standpoint on multiple things. Be it about cardiac arrest information which is shared on how do you give proper CPR, improving information and access to defibrillators in corporations as well as government offices. This is also doing a lot of work. I think there are two aspects of it. One aspect is what you put on the creative. So what is that you see on social media? This is what we're doing. The other aspect is also something which is happening in the back end, which is how the organization is perceiving their own mission and how they are focused towards.
Correct. Very true.
Yeah.
Great.
Stuti, how much time we have right now? It's almost over. We are overshot by half an hour. So if you have 2 minutes, there's a Tom Fuller video, which is absolutely brilliant in COVID times. If you can play, and that's downloaded also there. It's absolutely brilliant. I mean, very relevant, nothing more related to the business, but it's absolutely brilliant. Just to close, you have that video already downloaded.
I have it.
It's an amazing video.
Amazing video. You can, I mean, I've shared that link. Yeah. I mean, everybody will love it. If, I mean, that video made lot of rounds on WhatsApp long back, but I think so that's good enough to close. Sound.
Is it audible?
Yeah, so little bit audible, yeah.
Now?
Better.
Yeah.
The subtitles are coming down, so no problem.
Yeah.
Great one. What an ending. Great. So I'll just, if I have to sum up today's session, I'll do it in Baron Brown's words, that says that vulnerability is the birthplace of innovation, creativity and change. And that's what marketing is actually all about. So with this, I'd like to thank both our speakers and the participants. And I am very thankful to both of you on behalf of Department of Management Studies, Dean of the Department and Director. And it was great having both of you with us. Thank you very much for your time. And I would also like to extend my thanks to the participants for being so patient in being with us throughout the session. And my apologies for the technical glitch. Thank
no
you
issues.
So much.
Thanks, Suti. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Sachyam.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you, Sachyam.
Great meeting you. Thanks, Suti. Yeah. Thanks, everyone. Take care. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
Stay safe.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.